Good afternoon. Welcome to Theater 100. My name is Naomi Buckley, and I'm the instructor for this course, as you well know. This is week four, and we are going to be talking today about scenery for the stage, or designing scenery for the stage. That was chapter 10 in your reading for this week, and that was what your quiz was about as well. So we're going to start out by talking a little bit about, before we get to the elements of scenery, we're going to talk a little bit about some world theater history today. We're going to start in the Western world of theater, and we're going to talk about melodrama and the development of melodrama and how it became so popular in the 19th century, specifically in America, but also in parts of Europe. I do want to remind you that we are live and online right now. You can give us a call anytime during the broadcast at 1-800-339-1193. And you can also send in any of your questions or comments to askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So in order to give you something to talk about for this episode, we're going to send out our first question of the day, and that is, why did melodrama become the favorite form of theater in 19th century America? So why do you think that melodrama became one of the most popular forms of theater in 19th century America? I'd like to hear your answers on that. So make sure you call in or type in a response, especially because you want to get that extra credit, right? All right. Well, let's start off today by talking about 19th century theater and specifically some of the actors that were around at the time and very famous and popular. In fact, it was the 19th century and the melodrama as a form specifically that created this idea of celebrity performers. Before that time, we definitely had actors that were popular. But it wasn't until this time period that we really began having what we would think of today as the traditional theatrical celebrity. And obviously that's turned into the cinematic celebrity. But it was around this time that we started getting performers that were so well known and so widely loved that sometimes people even threw riots in the street when they couldn't see the performer that they came to see. And there are many examples of that throughout this particular time period. So many of the actors that were around originally were actually English actors at the beginning of the 19th century, and they were English actors that had been trained in England, especially in Shakespeare, and then came over to perform those roles over here. And it was full of great actors from England that were romantic in style, and the training that they had received and that they popularized at the time was a sort of larger-than-life performance. It was very bombastic and over-the-top, very energetic. And this style of acting became kind of the norm throughout most of the 19th century until we hit sort of the later part of it when naturalism or realism takes hold. And again, that's a fairly new development. We've only had realism with us really in terms of stylistic acting for the last 150 years. We take that for granted because it's all around us now, but it really is a very new style of performance within the theater. Edmund Kean was one of the more well-known actors. He was particularly well-known, there's a picture of him behind me, for playing Othello. And for any of you that might know Othello, of course, this is a play by Shakespeare that was written about a Moor. And a Moor was a way of describing someone who was probably dark-complexioned. Obviously, in this instance, they were talking about someone who would be from probably the north of Africa. And that's might be curious to some of you in that we didn't have a lot of African performers on stage in Europe or in America, definitely, for many, many years. And so what they did was they darkened the faces of the actors that played this part, Othello. They used rudimentary makeup, and sometimes they even used coal mixed with a type of oily like Vaseline and spread that on the skin in order to darken the skin so that these Caucasian light-skinned people could play this part. And Edmund Kean definitely was an Englishman, and he was not dark-skinned as you see him back there, but he was very well known for his portrayal of Othello. He was said to have a very wild personality and a wild personal life that was all the talk of the town and in all the, you know, the gossip at the time. And critics were very impressed by his sort of naked display of emotion. And what I mean by that is this sort of over the top and unabashed display of emotion. He was a very large performer with a lot of energy that he brought onto stage. In fact, a critic said of him once that watching Keane was like reading Shakespeare by flashes of lightning. So as you can tell from that review, he's a very powerful, energetic performer. In fact, today if we saw Edmund Kean perform, we might think of it him as being sort of not natural in any way and sort of over the top and totally not believable. In fact, I'm pretty sure we would think that. And that, again, is attributed to the style of acting that was present at the time. And it was acceptable, in fact, expected to be very large with your emotions and to be very theatrical. He unfortunately suffered from really serious alcoholism, and he burned out quite early on in his career as a result, and didn't work very much again later on in his life. But there were a lot of British stars that visited the United States again, primarily to perform Shakespeare, but also performing other things. Some of them are John Philip Kemble, Sarah Siddons, William McCready, Mademoiselle Vestris, Henry Irving, and Sarah Bernhardt. And so we can see that there are female and male actors that are gaining popularity and celebrity at this time. It wasn't until Edwin Forrest that an American actor really began to gain a name that would win any kind of lasting fame in the United States. And this was an American actor. You can see a picture of him behind me. He was a very barrel-chested man, as you can see from the picture, short and kind of burly, and was very well known for playing these kinds of characters. And he sort of popularized, you can see a great picture of him there. You can see very barrel-chested with a, you know, a full head of dark hair and a sort of very masculine man. And he really epitomized a style of acting that became associated with Americans. And this style was very physical in nature. It imbued certain heroic traits. And he was a very, as I said, had a very strong and physical physique that sort of made him an idol for theater goers. And he was known to get so passionate in his fight scenes that he would actually extend the scenes by several minutes because he'd be so into the fight scene that he'd just keep fighting even beyond when the choreography ended. Another really famous actor from the 19th century that played a lot in melodrama that was American is Edwin Booth. And he shares the last name of John Wilkes Booth, and it's no coincidence because they were brothers. I'm not sure how many of you remember this, but John Wilkes Booth was actually also an actor. Not a very good actor like his brother was. His brother was a very well-known and quite famous Shakespearean actor. But John Wilkes Booth was also an actor, which was part of the reason that he was in the theater that night when Lincoln was assassinated. But Edwin Booth, you know, became very famous, especially for his portrayal of Hamlet, which was one of the longest-running performances of Hamlet by an actor in the 19th century. One of the things that really typified melodrama of the 19th century was its use of spectacle. And this was one of the things that really drew audiences to the theater at this time. And it was because of the Industrial Revolution, in part, that these sorts of special effects were able to come about. There were a great many inventions that were happening in the time, mechanized inventions, and those inventions were translated and revamped to also work in the theater to create special effects. And we're going to see a picture of one of these samples of these special effects. It's right behind me. If we could bring that full screen, actually. There we go. Sweet. Just so you can get a better look at it. This is actually a lot of little visual vignettes of the different kinds of visual effects that they had at the time. You can see someone kind of coming through on what will be the left of your screen, a little elevator. You can see at the very bottom an effect for rowing on the water. You can see different effects for fire pyrotechnics and different things to that sort. So there were a lot of different advances that were being made that were being brought into the world of the theater in order to modernize the shows that you were seeing and add a lot of action and spectacle. And we're going to talk more carefully about what some of those spectacular special effects were. But Noah has written in, and I want to catch Noah's response. And he says that, "I think melodrama became popular during that time because so many people wanted some sort of entertainment and to escape from the stress of daily life." Absolutely, Noah. And in fact, isn't that why most of us go to the movies or to the theater or to see a concert, as a way of escaping our daily lives and to relieve stress? You do have to imagine at this time, this was the time of the Industrial Revolution. We have hordes of people moving out of the countryside and into the city because that's where all the jobs are. And we were moving from this sort of agrarian society that was based in agriculture to a more industrialized and mechanized society. And so with these huge factories being built and the sort of agricultural industry was drying up, and the mechanized and factory industries were growing, and so that's where a lot of the jobs were. People that had lived in the countryside their whole life were moving en masse into the cities. And so we had these huge, larger than ever numbers of people congregated in these metropolitan centers, and they needed something to entertain them, right? In addition to that, you have people working very long hours. In these factories, you know, the labor laws at the time were really non-existent. We had child laborers. We had people working sometimes 14, 15 hours a day. We had people working very difficult jobs, using their hands and using their bodies a lot. And so it's true, at the end of the day, they did want a relief from all of that. And in fact, because we had this mass of people moving into the city centers and taking up these jobs that paid fairly well, comparatively to some of the agricultural jobs before, we had this growing and burgeoning middle class. So in addition to having a large mass of people that are working long hours and needing distraction, as well as suddenly having the money to afford these types of distractions, these are all multiple reasons that contributed to melodrama becoming popular. But again, does anyone else have any other ideas? The question for the day, I know they just put it up there, is why do you think that melodrama became such a popular form of theater in 19th century America? And again, you can call in. The number will be up in a second, or you can also type in askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So what do we mean when we say melodrama? I know we've defined that in class before, but I'd like to give a really specific definition. This is a term that could show up on one of your tests eventually, so make sure that you have a clear definition. This definition actually comes from your textbook. It says, historically, a distinct form of drama popular throughout the 19th century, which emphasized action and spectacular effect and use music to heighten the dramatic mood. Melodrama has stock characters and clearly defined villains and heroes. More generally, the term is applied to any dramatic play which presents an unambiguous confrontation between good and evil. Characterization is often shallow and stereotypical, and because the moral conflict is externalized, action and violence are predominant, usually culminating in a happy ending meant to demonstrate the eventual triumph of good over evil. So there are some really important things in there in that definition that I want to point out to you. First of all, that the focus of a melodrama is not on the internal conflict of the characters, but the conflict itself has been externalized into sort of these anthropomorphized versions of good and evil and every man and all these things, very much like the morality plays of the 14th and 15th century. And so we do very much in these plays, we have characters that are sort of like the man in white and the man in black and the damsel in distress. As it said before, another really important part of this is that when you externalize an internal conflict, you end up with sort of these stock characters to represent these very big generalized ideas. It also means that we don't have a lot of introspection. We have a lot of action, in fact, taking place. So the conflict is not internalized, it's externalized. And so all of the focus of the plot is usually very action-based. And it's about a bad guy chasing a good guy, or a good guy chasing a bad guy, or a good guy trying to rescue a damsel in distress, and so on and so forth. It also, if we're trying to, you know, be so clear about these things and not have a really sort of complicated interpretation, and we're focusing more on spectacle and external action, then we don't allow for really deep character development. And in fact, that's what we see happening in melodrama. We see characters that are very two-dimensional, sort of stereotypical. The good guy is all good, the bad guy is all bad. He's twisting his mustache in the corner and rubbing his hands together. And the damsel in distress is completely helpless, right, and naive. And so these are some of the really important elements, as well as the fact that in addition to the special effects and the action of the plot, that there was a lot of music used inside of melodrama. This eventually transfers to film later on in silent films. But there was a lot of music, a lot of accompaniment used with the melodramas. And this was intended to enhance the emotionality of the scene. In fact, we carry this with us even today. Most cinema that you watch today, when you go into the movie theater, has a soundtrack. It has an extensive soundtrack that plays underneath almost every single scene that you're watching. In fact, when there isn't music or some sort of sound happening in the background of a film, you tend to notice it. Even if you don't recognize it with your conscious mind, you'll notice it sort of subconsciously and feel like something's wrong or that maybe the film is slowed down in some way. The word melodrama itself actually comes to us from the French, mello meaning music, and drama obviously meaning drama or theater. And so the word itself actually means drama with music underneath it, and it did originate in France. All right, so we did kind of cover why melodrama became so popular, but just to recap that, and if anyone has anything they want to add to it, it was a sort of influx of a middle class population from the countryside into the city, people earning more money so that they could actually afford to go and see the theater and wanting to have these kinds of distractions because they were working such long and difficult hours in these factories. Spectacle became a really important part of melodrama. It was one of the major things that drew these audiences into the theater. And you might think of it today, the corollary today might be what we would call a blockbuster film in the cinema. And these kinds of films tend to be just very expansive, epic, with amazing effects and visuals, right? And that's the sort of thing that we think of as a blockbuster. It's this film that's going to draw all these people to see it because of its just amazing visuals and its expansive nature. And these sort of things, even in film today, but definitely back in the time of melodrama, this sort of spectacle actually started overshadowing the story. The spectacle became kind of the most important part. The audiences were so drawn to it that the story became kind of secondary, and it became more about the sort of effects and how audacious could we be on stage. This is especially true with a story called Uncle Tom's Cabin, written in 1901. And this was originally a play that was written by Harriet Beecher Stowe, and it was a play that had a very strong message of anti-slavery. It's actually about a woman who escapes. She escapes from her owner, and she goes on the run. And it is a strong message against slavery. It had a lot of social context along with it. Now, this piece of literature was adapted into a play. And what happened with the play, because it was adapted during this time period, was adapted into a melodrama. And the melodrama itself sort of lost all of the social and political messages that were in the original piece and became more of a work of spectacular effects. Some of the examples of this is where there were, you can see in the picture behind me, they actually brought live horses onto the stage in the famous scene where Eliza crosses the frozen river trying to get away from the slave owners that are chasing her. And there were tons of these effects where they would bring, horses and, have fake gunfire and all these things on stage. And these were the reasons why people came to see the play. And in fact, the play became so popular that it ran for many, many years until 1927. But certainly, most people were not coming to see it because of the political message. They were coming because it was such a spectacle and it was just such a fantastic visual feast. And that is a lot of what happened. We actually have a small clip from a cinematic version of Uncle Tom's Cabin that was recorded some years later. And I think it'll be interesting for you to see this. I do want to remind you that this is a clip from a silent film. And so there is, I think, some music, but there we won't be able to hear the actors talk. We will see a small subtitle or title that comes on before, sort of describing the scene that happens after. And then we'll see the actors pantomiming, but we won't be able to hear any of the words that they say. So I think you'll enjoy this. This is from Uncle Tom's Cabin. So a fun clip from the silent film Uncle Tom's Cabin, and you could see, I mean, can you even imagine watching that on stage as they recreated the frozen lake that Eliza and her child would run across with live horses on stage and the slave owners trying to chase after her and unable to because they can't go across the frozen water. So amazing, and also, you know, it makes perfect sense that with a sort of theater that was so popular amongst the middle classes and also so focused on spectacle that these sorts of things would make easy transitions into the world of cinema. And in fact, it is the world of melodrama that has probably, and the whole sort of style of melodrama that in many ways has had a huge amount of impact on film and television. So many of the subgenres that we have or that were created during that time have translated even to the present day. Because it really wasn't until that time that we had such a wide variety of these different stories that were so action focused. And it allowed for a wide and different varying styles of storytelling. And some of the subgenres that came out of this time were things like pirate stories, or you know, desert island stories, also detective stories, stories that sort of are like the Sherlock Holmes idea, romantic comedies, even though obviously Shakespeare was writing that many, many years before, and action, sort of, as we talked about before, action films and things like that, science fiction, and mystery as well. All of these genres were really sort of begun, the seeds of them were begun on the stage of melodrama in the 19th century. There are so many stories of how spectacular the effects were in the different kinds of things. For instance, there's stories of them, like in the many different pirate tales that they would have, of actually bringing ships, mini small-scale ships, onto the stage and filling it with water so that it actually looked like they were on a ship. And we'll talk more about some of the other ones. There was actually a whole sort of stage that was devised to allow for faster scene changes to take place. And this is called the elevator stage. And it was specifically used in the Madison Square Theater, but it also translated to other places. There's a picture of it here. If we can bring that full screen so everyone can take a look at it. There we go. You have a better look at it there. So you can see to your right of the screen, you see those little people on the lower level. Those are people on the main proscenium stage, and that's what the audience is seeing. But what you can also see is if you look, because this is a cutaway picture, if you look on the left-hand side of the screen, this is actually behind scenes. This is actually what the audience cannot see that part. They've simply cut it away so that we can see it in this diagram. You can see that there is an upper level concealed from the audience that is a whole nother set that's existing above. And so the way that this would work was actually there would be two, sometimes three levels to these elevator stages. And they would have one scene set up, and they would play that scene. And then if they wanted to go to a different location, or if it was a variety of stories being told, a different whole different play or world, they would simply lower or raise the stage to show the next whole different set or location that they would be at. So you can imagine you have this whole stage that's moving up and down, and you've got a whole nother set and scenery and all different kinds of things. You could go from an interior scene to an exterior scene, or from a scene that was supposed to take place on, you know, an island to a scene that's supposed to take place in the city. So you had a lot of flexibility in the types of things that you could show, and you could show them very quickly. The changes could take place a lot faster than they had before. Keep in mind that a lot of this wasn't fully mechanized yet, so it wasn't like we were just pushing a button and things were moving up and down. It was, a lot of this was still manpowered, but still this was on pulleys and stuff, so it could move, you know, several minutes, but that's so much faster than what they were doing before when you consider, and then the flexibility with this the staging is just amazing. In fact, there is a very famous scene that apparently took place where a burglar was getting away from the cops, and he climbs out of a window and down a fire escape, and as he's escaping down the fire escape, the stage is moving up. So he's actually going down into the next scene while the stage is moving up, and then he's in a whole entire new location. So you can see that these things had just amazing potential for effects, things that people had never seen before with the use of these new inventions that were developed in the Industrial Revolution. Another really famous spectacle was in New York. It was a horse race that was perfected quite perfectly visually. You can see it again behind me. And this included, you can see, not only just the horses, which were with their riders on conveyor belts, so you can see there. So the horses can actually run, right, running on these conveyor belts. And then in addition, behind the performers upstage, they have a diorama running, which is a piece of scenery that's set on two spools that runs to make it look like the riders are actually moving physically on the stage, right? But instead of them moving, it's actually the diorama that's moving behind them. I mean, can you imagine this amazing piece of machinery and all the technical craftsmanship that went into that just to do this, you know, this horse race so realistically? And that is one of the elements that melodrama, for all of its hyperbole, was really trying to do. It was trying to represent real life in a way that had been sort of impossible before. Remember that in the past, we had these sort of sets, like back in Greece and even in Shakespeare's time. In fact, we didn't really have sets. We had scenery that was stationary and that really didn't change, and the audience was supposed to imagine the different locations that we were we were going to be moving into, and the dialogue was written in such a way that the audience was alerted to, oh, okay, now we're in this other place, right? But now as things have become, as we begin advancing in the way that we're going to display our scenery, we come into the Renaissance period, and we haven't really talked about this a lot, but we will later. The Renaissance, we develop these sort of flats or panels that create a forced perspective. But again, these panels are for the most part initially very stationary, and they're simple paintings intended to create a visual setting for the audience and the actors. Sometimes they would have these flats move in and out, so maybe you went from the outside to the inside. Some years later, they became more advanced, and we got a pole and chariot system that allowed us to move several flats fairly quickly. But again, these are painted stationary flats, and we don't really have a three-dimensional set, so to speak. And we certainly don't have actors really using a lot of what we would call levels or platforms or things like that. Everyone's all on the same playing field, and possibly in a raked stage, which means that the stage itself would be at an angle, with the lower portion being closer to the audience and the portion that's higher being farthest away from the audience. But realism was one of the reasons why the practitioners of melodrama were sort of inventing and creating all these really spectacular events. It was to try to duplicate life. And part of the reason for that was because in the hurry and flurry of all the new inventions that were coming out in the Industrial Revolution, one of the things that came out was in 1839, Daguerre invented the first camera. So we get the invention of this device that can take photographs of real life, the way it looks to you or I in this particular instance, and it's an objective picture of what this moment looked like. And we can look at it 10, 15 years from now, and it will still have perfectly captured that instance in time. And that was something that no other previous time in humanity had we had. If we wanted to have a picture of something before, we would have to ask a painter to come, or someone who had artistic skills to come and paint this image for us. And obviously painting something or drawing something takes a lot more time than snapping a photograph. Even when you think about the old photographs, it took several minutes, sometimes 5 to 10 minutes, to actually get enough light on the film to actually develop an image. That was still much faster than the, you know, sometimes hours that it would take for an artist to draw a picture of a person or a place. So with this ability to very realistically capture everyday life on film, artists began sort of shifting their perspective out of the world of the theatrical and the fantastical, and into the world of how close to reality can we be? How realistic can we be? How can we, as artists, mimic real life? Because that's what technology is able to do as well. So this is part of why all of these things are developing simultaneously and kind of feeding into one another and adding back to one another in the same way. All right, we have someone responding again to our question. Remember, it was, why do you think that melodrama became a popular form of theater in the 19th century? And Jordan O says, I think one reason melodrama may have become more popular in the 19th century is because people would like to watch good overcoming evil. I think that aspect of melodrama would give people hope and encouragement. Definitely. Again, dealing with a highly religious population, a group of people that are all still, for the most part, very staunchly Christian, and they like to hear stories about good triumphing over evil. And in their everyday lives, you have to imagine that this is not a world that is particularly kind, and there's still a lot of illness and a lot of things that they can't control. And so, yes, going to a place where we see everyone always, the good, happy ending always be the ending, is very comforting in a lot of ways. Also, Seth wrote in, and he said, melodrama was something exciting to take their minds off of their routine lives. It gave them something else to think about even during the next day at work. They could talk with their coworkers about the last drama. Yes, very much like television today, right? We all want to, as they say, stand around the water cooler and talk about, excuse me, what happened last night in Breaking Bad, or what happened last night in, you know, not Twilight, but True Blood, that other vampire show. And we all want to talk about what's happening in our favorite characters. So definitely it was a very social interaction that they all had. We do have a call coming in. Hopefully it's Katie. And I'd like to take the call before we continue reading. So we're going to Katie.
Hi.
Hi, Katie.
Hi. So in response to your question, I think melodrama was so popular because it was a new and exciting form. People felt like they could interact with what was happening at the theater, and it literally brought the theater to life.
Mm-hmm. It really did. It brought the theater to life in a way that they hadn't seen before. They were actually being asked to use their imaginations less and being shown these sort of spectacular things that really had never happened on stage before. In fact, me and myself today, I would like to see an elevator stage. I would love to see these whole sets moving up and down. We are drawn to things like that, things that are fantastic, things that are sort of outside of our everyday experience. And so definitely, this is part of the reason why we go to see concerts and theater today. But definitely, that's a wonderful answer. Thank you, Katie.
Thank you.
And so Noah also has written in, and I want to read his answer. And he says, I think melodrama became popular during that time because many people wanted some sort of entertainment and to escape the stress of daily life. And Seth says, elevator sets are very cool. Do they use things like that in, I'm imagining the rest of that is in the theater today. Things like that, modern plays to lift whole sets. Very good. Okay, so Seth, yes and no. Today, a lot of times on Broadway stages, you will see some really magnificent effects, and they do have the ability to lift whole sets in and out. But when you think about the way that most of our the plays that have a lot of spectacle in it, which would be the Broadway plays, and typically musicals. When we think about the sorts of ways that our theater is run today, which is that in order for a show to really make money, even after it's been on Broadway, is that the show has to be able to tour. It needs to be able to go to a lot of different venues across the country in order to make back the enormous amount of money that they spend to make the play. And then considering that the population that goes to see a play, even a Broadway musical, is much smaller than the population that goes to see something like a film or even watch television or something like that. So because of that, because of the requirements of a show needing to be able to travel, and that's always the hope in the back of everyone's head when we're designing a show that is going to end up somewhere off Broadway or hopefully on Broadway. A lot of times shows are designed with that in mind, that it needs to be able to travel. And so when we think about that and we think about the cost of having something like an elevator stage, and that most likely something like that would have to be a stage that is already in existence, which was what the Madison Square Theater was. That stage was always like that. It was always an elevator stage. It wasn't like, it was that way sometimes, only when this one show came in. It was built to be that way. And so since we don't have, as far as I know, any of those stages still in existence, we may, I'm not sure. To design a play around that idea would probably be very detrimental to the eventual tour of your show and very, very cost prohibitive. So as much as it would be amazing to see something like that take place today, I don't think that we're really going to see things like that. What we do see, though, is something that's sort of a similar effect. One thing that all theaters have pretty much across the board, no matter where you go, is what we call a very large fly space. And this is a space that exists above the proscenium line, or above where the performance takes place, the visual part. And it's covered, it's unseen by the audience. If you ever come and see a show at our large main stage theater, what you see happening on the proscenium, we have at least that same amount in space above the actors as well. And that space above the actors in the performance space is called fly space. And the reason why it's called fly space is because we need that area in order to be able to fly or bring things in and out of the plane space from the area above. So if you imagine that most theaters have very large fly spaces, they have this very tall area, sometimes at least as big as the plane space that you're viewing, sometimes more than that. What usually is done nowadays is that we will fly scenic elements in and fly other scenic elements out. And this is a lot of what you see on Broadway stages. This is the way they transform the stages very, very quickly. It's through the use of wagons, and we're going to talk about that in a second, as well as flying set pieces in and out. And so the way that this is done is that we attach these set pieces to a baton, which is basically a long metal rod that is tied up to a pulley system that exists up in the fly space and goes across to the fly rails. In the modern systems today, the most advanced systems, the fly rails are completely mechanized and automated. That means that the pulley system that takes this piece of scenery up or down, meaning into this the plane space or out of the plane space, is mechanized. I, as a stagehand, or sometimes even as a stage manager simply from above, I just press a button and that piece of scenery goes up and the wheels turn and they pull the ropes and everything happens. But a lot of theaters still operate on a manual fly system, and even our theater is still on a manual fly system. And that's where we have a series of ropes that's set along one side of the stage. Sometimes they're along both sides, but usually, typically, it's along one side. And our stage here at Dominguez, it's on the left-hand side of the stage, stage left. And there are a series of pulleys and ropes that are attached to different batons that hang in the fly space. And what you need is a pretty strong person to get on that pulley. You unlock the rope and you pull on it, and that pulling down on one direction or pulling up on the other either lowers or raises the piece of scenery, or sometimes the electric, which has all the instruments on it. So by doing that, we can affect a similar sort of change. We obviously can't magically make the actors go up and down unless we have them on in harnesses or something. But we can really create a very dramatic scenic change very quickly through the use of flying scenic pieces in and out. The most recent sort of big scale Broadway show that I saw, actually saw it on Broadway, was Kinky Boots. And Kinky Boots uses a lot of instances of flying scenery in and out and the use of wagons to really transform the space sort of instantaneously. And the way that they do it is through the use of those flown set pieces and the fly rail. So that's how we achieve that sort of same magical effect nowadays without having to use the elevator stage, which I still think is amazing, but is pretty cost prohibitive in terms of what it entails to make it work. All right. At the same time, when all this is happening, one of the things, and remember I mentioned this all the way at the beginning of the broadcast, is that it becomes really acceptable for women to be on stage. One of the sort of leading female playwrights that made this possible, she was also an actress, was Anna Cora Mowatt. And she was around in 1845, and she wrote a very, very popular comedy called Fashion or Life in New York. And it was a satire on foreign manners. And it played for many, many performances. It was very, very popular. And it was not only that play, but her involvement in the theater that really started to mainstream the involvement of women in the theater world. And it sort of destigmatized it. Because remember, before this point, first of all, until the Restoration in England, there were only men on stage, at least in Western theater. And then even after that point, when in England, after Restoration, King Charles said, okay, it's legal for women to be on stage, it still wasn't really looked upon very highly. It was not a profession that a respectable woman would do. And so really, it's not until the 19th century, and even in mid to late 19th century, that it becomes acceptable for a woman to do this job and to not really be stigmatized by it. It's unfortunate, but women that did this job up until that point were often looked at kind of like prostitutes or harlots, that they were sort of prostituting themselves. They were showing themselves off on stage, and it was not very ladylike. But during this time, that stigma is sort of removed, and it becomes acceptable for women to be on stage and also to become these sort of celebrities that are very well known. Well, after the big movement in melodrama happens, we have a huge shift in the theater towards the end of the 19th century going into the 20th century. And we move away from the bombastic acting and even some of the spectacle into a new genre of theater called realism. And this sort of realism spreads throughout all of theater and even makes its way into the cinema. In fact, cinema has inherited realism from the theater. And it changes the way that playwrights are writing plays. It changes the style of sets that are on stage. And it changes the way that actors are performing the plays. So we're going to hear about that in a second. I want to read this one response from Shannon, and then we'll take also a quick break before we come back to realism. But let's read this first. Shannon says, I think that melodrama became popular in the 19th century because of the changes in society that were taking place. As people transitioned into a more modern world, they needed more of an escape, and the performances could offer that for them. They also had new innovations in the sets, and since it was a novel thing, everyone wanted to see it, which would have added popularity. Very nice, Shannon, absolutely. Lots of things converging at once, right, to make this a very popular form of theater at the time. All right, we're going to take a 5-minute break. When we come back, we're going to finish up on talking about realism, and then we're going to talk a little bit more about sets and scenery. All right, I'll see you back in 5 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills. Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You ought to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. To want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
Hello.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. This is Theater 100, and I'm Naomi Buckley. Well, we ended just before the break talking about realism and how realism was the new movement that was starting towards the end of the 19th century. It came onto the scene. It started really in Russia with writers like Anton Chekhov and also Henrik Ibsen. And Ibsen and Chekhov were known, as well as other playwrights that we'll talk about in a moment, for a new style of writing for the theater. We have Chekhov right behind me. And this style of writing was very subtle and very realistic in its representation of the different characters. In fact, it included something that perhaps we had never seen before on the stage, and that was the idea of subtext. And subtext is when we actually, we've talked about this before, but it's the thoughts, ideas, and feelings that exist for the actor underneath the words that they say. And it was really this movement of realism and these writers that brought the idea of subtext onto the stage. Up until this point, most of the things that actors and things that had been written for actors for the stage were all very, let's say, literal. In other words, if I had a feeling that I wanted to express to you, I would simply express it. And if I didn't express it right at the time, I would have a soliloquy or an aside to the audience to let the audience know exactly what it was that I was thinking. There was really no subterfuge. And in that way, the characters were had a quality that was very superficial in a way, a surfacey quality to them that we don't get in a lot of the characters that we see today. And that is in part because of the efforts of writers like Chekhov, Ibsen, and George Bernard Shaw. One of the plays that became very popular that Ibsen wrote was A Doll's House. Not only was it written in a very different way, it was written about a topic that was incredibly taboo at the time. It was written about a woman who is kept by her husband almost like a doll. And it's not just that this, it was, you know, just this one woman, but it was the plight of many women at the time, that they were kept more as objects, more almost as little children that were incapable of really taking care of themselves or being independent thinkers. And they were treated as such by not only their husbands usually, but by most of the male society at the time. Ibsen writes a story about a woman who lives this sort of life and sort of has a realization that she doesn't want to live this life anymore. And in fact, at the end of the play, she leaves her husband and her children in order to sort of find herself and to become her own independent person. So a very striking, even today, almost taboo subject written in a very realistic, very touching way. We actually have a clip from a film version of A Doll's House, and we'll go ahead and watch this scene now. It's the scene at the very end where she leaves her husband.
It means that she's become his in a double sense, his wife and his child.
Sit down, Torvald. You and I have a lot to talk about. Doesn't anything strike you about the way we're sitting here?
What?
We've been married 8 years. This is the first time that you and I, man and wife, have ever had a serious talk together.
You didn't expect me to drag you into all my worries. You couldn't possibly have helped me with that.
That's not what I mean. When I lived with Papa, he used to tell me what he thought about everything, and I took on his opinions. He used to call me his little doll. And he used to play games with me, just the way I played with my dolls. And then I came to live in your house.
Have you never been happy here?
I always thought I was, but I haven't ever been. No, I've had fun. You've always been very kind to me, Torvald, but this house is like a playroom. My children have been my dolls.
No, you exaggerate.
I'm giving you my point of view for once.
So, playing is over. We'll begin again. Now comes time to learn.
Whose time to learn? Mine or the children's?
Both, my dear Nora.
Oh, Torvald, you're not the man to teach me to be the right wife for you. And what about me? Am I fit to educate the children? You said yourself that you couldn't leave them in my charge. You're right. I have to educate myself first, and you can't do that for me. That is something that I must do for myself. That is why I'm leaving you.
What did you say?
I'm leaving you now. Christine will put me up for tonight. Tomorrow I shall go home, to where I was born. It'll be easier for me to get a job there.
You've no experience of the world.
I must try to get some, Torvald.
You forget your most sacred duties. Your husband, your children, your position as mother and wife.
I have another duty. Equally sacred, if that is the word. My duty to myself.
You're first and foremost a wife and mother.
I can't believe that anymore. I believe that first and foremost I am a human being like you, or I must become one.
I presume you have some sense of duty left, or perhaps you haven't. Well, answer me.
Torvald, I simply don't know. All I know is that these things mean something quite different to me than they do to you. I have learned now that there are laws that are different from the way I imagined them to be, and I can't accept that such laws are right.
You don't love me.
No. That's exactly it.
Nora, how can you say such things to me?
I can't help it. I don't love you anymore. I waited patiently for 8 years. I'm not such a fool as to believe that miracles happen every day. And when this dreadful thing happened to me, I knew a miracle would come. When that letter from Krogstad was lying out there, it never occurred to me for a moment that you would accept his conditions. I knew that you would step forward and take the blame. Torval, I never would have accepted such a sacrifice from you. But that was the miracle that I was waiting for. And it was to prevent the consequences to you that I was willing to take my life.
No man can be expected to sacrifice his honor, not even for the person he loves.
Millions of women have done it.
I have the strength to change, Nora.
Perhaps, if your doll is taken from you. I don't want to see the children. As I am now, I can be nothing to them.
Nora, can I never be anything but a stranger to you?
Oh, Torval, I don't believe in miracles anymore. We would have to change so much.
So very moving scene, even in modern times, right? A woman leaving her husband and her children so that she can become, as she said, a human being, right? A person in her own right, which she has not felt that she has been up until that point. And the play remains a very moving piece of theater, and at the time was not only moving, but just very daring in the topic and the way that it was written. During this time as well, Stanislavski begins to work on his system for a naturalistic acting. He's also working with Anton Chekhov to write and direct and perform plays that are in this new style of realism. George Bernard Shaw is also writing at the time, and he's writing in England, and he writes Mrs. Warren's Profession. And this is a very interesting play. With a lot of realism in it, even though it takes place in the sophisticated world of the aristocratic England. So we'll take a look at Mrs. Warren's Profession by George Bernard Shaw.
Perfectly splendid.
Hmm?
When I was your age, young men and women were afraid of each other. There was no good fellowship. Nothing was real. Only gallantry copied out of novels, and as vulgar and affected as could be. Maidenly reserve, gentlemanly chivalry, always saying no when you meant yes. Simple purgatory for shy and sincere souls.
Yes, I imagine there must have been a frightful waste of time. Especially women's time.
Oh, waste of life, waste of everything. But things are improving. Well, I've been in a positive state of excitement about meeting you ever since your magnificent achievements at Cambridge. A thing unheard of in my day. It was perfectly splendid of you tying with the third wrangler. Just the right place, you know. The first wrangler is always a dreamy, morbid fellow in whom the thing is pushed to the length of a disease.
Mm. It doesn't pay. I wouldn't do it again for the same money.
The same money?
I did it for £50.
£50?
Yes, £50. Oh, perhaps you don't know how it was. Well, Mrs. Latham, my tutor at Newnham, had told my mother that I could distinguish myself in the mathematical tripos if I went in for it in earnest. Well, the papers were just full then of Philippa Summers beating the senior wrangler. Well, you remember it, of course. Well, anyhow, she did. And nothing would please my mother but that I should do the same thing. Well, I told her flatly it wasn't worth my while to face the grind because I wasn't going in for teaching. But I offered to try for fourth wrangler, or thereabouts, for £50. Well, she closed with me on that after a bit of grumbling, and I was better than my bargain. But I wouldn't do it again for the same money. £200 would be nearer the mark.
Oh, Lord bless me. It's a very practical way of looking at it.
Did you expect to find me an unpractical person?
But surely, isn't it practical to consider not only the work these honours cost, but also the culture they bring?
Culture? My dear Mr. Prey, do you know what the mathematical tripos means? It means grind, grind, grind for 6 to 8 hours a day at mathematics, and nothing but mathematics. I'm supposed to know something about science, but I know nothing but the mathematics it involves. I can make calculations for engineers, electricians, insurance companies, and so on, but I know next to nothing about engineering, electricity, or insurance. I don't even know arithmetic well.
Outside mathematics, lawn tennis, eating, sleeping, cycling and walking, I'm a more ignorant barbarian than any woman could possibly be who hadn't gone in for the tripos.
What a wicked, monstrous, rascally system. I knew it. I felt at once that it meant destroying everything that makes womanhood beautiful.
No, I don't object to it on that score in the least. No, I shall put it to very good account, I assure you.
In what way?
I shall set up in chambers in the city and work at actuarial calculations and conveyancing. Under cover of that, I'll do some law, with one eye on the stock exchange all the time. I've come down here by myself to read law. Not for a holiday, as my mother imagines. I hate holidays.
You make my blood run cold. Are you to have no romance, no beauty in your life?
Oh, I don't care for either, I assure you.
You can't mean that.
Yes, I do. I like working and getting paid for it. And when I'm tired of working, I like a comfortable chair, a cigar, a little whiskey, and a novel with a good detective story in it.
I don't believe it. I'm an artist, and I can't believe it. I refuse to believe it. It's just that you haven't discovered yet what a wonderful world art can open up to you.
Yes, I have. Last May, I spent 6 weeks in London with Honoria Fraser. Mama thought we were doing a round of sightseeing together, but actually, I was at Honoria's chambers in Chancery Lane working out at actuarial calculations for her and helping her as well as a greenhorn could. And in the evenings, we smoked and talked and never thought of going out except for exercise, and I never enjoyed myself more in my life. I cleared up all my expenses and got initiated into the business without a fee into the bargain.
But bless my heart and soul, Miss Warren, do you call that discovering art?
Oh, wait a bit, that wasn't the beginning. I went up to town on the invitation of some artistic people who lived in Fitzjohn's Avenue. Well, one of the girls was a Newnham chum. And they took me...
So a wonderful little scene in which we see a female presented in sort of the opposite way that they were typically thought of for the time. Not only is she very proficient at mathematics, but she's not at all interested in any kind of romance or art or culture as her scene partner asks her, and written in a very realistic way where the characters are just talking to each other as they would, you know, in real life, in a regular conversation. All right, we're going to use the last part of the broadcast today to quickly go over chapter 10. I want to start with another question that you can think about and type in, answer or call if you'd like, and that is, what do you think Robert Edmund Jones meant when he said players act in a setting, not against it? Players act in a setting, not against it. So think about that. We also have Ayn. He's got a question here about referring back to melodrama. And he says, is opera considered a form of melodrama? No, it isn't, Ayn. Actually, opera came about in Italy during the Renaissance. And it was actually as a result of a misinterpretation of some of the classical Greek and Roman texts, where the Italians actually thought that all of the texts were sung instead of just the choral parts. The parts that were spoken by the chorus were actually sung sometimes, but the rest of it was spoken just as in a normal play. The Italians misinterpreted that, and they haphazardly created opera. and yes, it is very spectacular, very over the top in a lot of cases, completely sung with lots of music, but it actually evolved out of a misinterpretation of ancient texts. And even though there is a similarity between the two, melodrama actually comes from a completely different line of theatrical heritage. It comes from things like the operetta and different other forms of combining music and theater out of France. All right, so let's talk about scenery. This was chapter 10 in your textbook. We're going to take a look at, during the course of our semester, we're going to take a look at all kinds of different forms of design elements in the theater, including costumes, lights, and sounds. And we're going to think about what designers do and the technical aspects of their job and how it contributes to the overall feeling and production of a play. The history of scenery, as your text shows, is that scenery came in with the Renaissance. As we said before that time, really, we didn't have scenery. The Greeks and Asians had conventionalized structures that served for the play. On the whole, there was no different scenic elements that came in at different moments. It was all the same thing. And even in the Renaissance, even though we had some more scenic elements than the Greeks had, there was still very limited scenery. The sort of scenery that we know of as today really came in the 19th and 20th century. But there's a lot of different types of scenery that has existed since that time. And as I mentioned before, some of it was these painted flats, the painted scenery that evolved in the 16th century Renaissance with the rake stages, which are the stages that are at an angle like this, with this part up here farthest away from the audience and also being higher, and this part down here being closer to the audience, so that when the actors were actually walking to what we would call upstage, they were actually walking up the rake. And when they were walking closer to the audience, and we would call that downstage, it was because they were actually walking down the rake. So it was an angled platform that was used. And this was because the audience itself wasn't raked. Nowadays, when you go into a movie theater or a typical theater, the audience is raked. So they are on an angle like this so that they can see the stage clearly. But before that, before we raked the audience, we raked the actors, and this again was for sightline issues. So again, we have upstage and downstage that evolved out of that. Upstage meaning farthest away from the audience, downstage meaning closer to the audience. And in the classical period, obviously, this was because the stage itself was raked. We also have stage right and stage left, which is always the actor stage right and the actor stage left. If we're going to talk about the audience, we're going to talk about the house right and house left. But when we're giving directions on the stage and when we're thinking about scenery being placed on the stage, we're always talking about it from the actor's perspective. And so that would be the actor's left and the actor's right. And behind me, you're seeing some wonderful pictures from actually a musical that I directed a few years ago, Cabaret. And it had a beautiful set, an amazing set. So when Edward Gordon Craig began using all of this in the 20th century, people thought that it was a miracle. They thought it was amazing how the rake scenery and all that allowed you to see the audience members in the stage right and the stage left, but he was really borrowing from a long tradition of things that had happened. Adolf Appiah was one of our first modern scenic designers, and he was one of the first designers to really design in 3D. And he thought, well, if the actor is operating in 3D, shouldn't the set be in 3D too, right? It shouldn't just be these two-dimensional flats. It should be 3D. It should surround the actor. The actor should be in the middle of it, right? And so he was really the true innovator of 3D scenery. And there are two types of scenery today. There's movable and permanent. Movable, which is, as we said before, these things move either on fly rails or on wagons. And permanent, which we would also call sort of like a unit set. It's a set that does not move and sort of stands in for all the different scenes, maybe with a few little pieces coming in and out to change the location. But thanks to, you know, fly sets and turntable sets and all these different kinds of things, we have a wide variety of things that we can do with scenery today. Most of our plays are performed even today in our proscenium theater, which we also call a picture box theater. In fact, a whole box set, as we said before, this is a picture of proscenium theater here, and that's where the stage is framed out by the proscenium and the audience sits looking towards the actors that play on that picture frame stage. But whole box sets, as I said, can be flown in and out on fly rails, and also the sides can be flying in, different pieces can fly in, big curtains can fly in. Here you can see, remember earlier I was talking about the fly space right here. That's the fly space. This is the area where we're going to fly things in and out. Here is obviously the audience. And this right here, that would be, obviously this is a cutaway. This is the proscenium, the picture frame that goes around. And then our actors are, of course, right here. Wow, my actor has a really long neck. But this is where we can fly things in and out from this space here. So we can do all kinds of things, and we can even have turntables and wagons. And wagons are set pieces which are rolled out on wheels. This is the other thing that I was talking about that they use a lot of on Broadway. And that's where we have maybe platforms that come out or whole different set pieces that can come out on a wagon. We wheel it out on a wagon and it locks. It has like a braking system on it so that it doesn't move around when the actors are on it. And then when that's done, they can roll them back out. And in fact, today in the big Broadway shows, like I said, Kinky Boots and The Lion King and those things, those wagons are often automated, meaning that they have little electric engines underneath them and the wheels, and they have a remote control and they just move them on and off like that. We don't actually have people moving these anymore. Obviously, on our stage here at Dominguez, we do use people to move those things in and out. We have to use some muscle to do that. But it is amazing how many Broadway shows use these types of effects to really create many different set designs, many different locations, and a feeling of really changing from place to place, and a lot of spectacle. So obviously, we also have permanent sets. These are sets that, as I said, typically unit sets, where we have one setting that's set up and it sort of plays as a lot of different locations. In the pictures that they were showing before, Cabaret, that was sort of how that set worked. It was somewhat of a unit set. We did have some pieces that flew in and out, but it was basically a unit set. And we had some pieces that came in for some scenes and some small elements that came in and out. But unit sets are used a lot today just simply for their flexibility and their cost effectiveness. We also can have sets that have multiple sets, meaning maybe we have different spaces on the stage, and this one's somebody's house, and this one's somebody else's house, and this is the doctor's office, or things like that. Or this is somebody's house, and this is a different location completely. So we can have multiple sets on stage, or we can have, like we said, things maybe on wagons. There's a unit set, and maybe there's a wagon that comes out for one particular scene. When I did Macbeth, I had a scene in a bar, and I know that sounds not like Macbeth, but it was for my Macbeth. We had a scene in a bar, and that was actually on a wagon, and we brought the bar in on a wagon, and then we wheeled the wagon out, and it didn't really get used. I think it got used one other time. So we can do these different kinds of things with a variety of different kinds of mechanisms. In Death of a Salesman, which was a very popular play on Broadway, there was an elevated area that was meant to be the boys' room. And here you can see it. There's a set of stairs you can see that lead up here. And this is the boys' bedroom. And it's really important because a lot takes place in that bedroom. In addition, in the original Broadway production, and you can kind of see it here and here and here, although this isn't the original Broadway production, there is a use of scrim. And scrim is a piece of fabric that when we shine light on it from a particular angle, the things behind it become translucent. So right now, there's not light shining through it, so it's opaque, meaning we can't see through it. But when we shine light from a different angle, you can actually see through that. And that was how they did a lot of those flashback scenes. Here also you see, I think these are used as scrim and bed too. Okay, so we can have different levels and all different kinds of things, but in this case, like with The Death of a Salesman, this is a unit set, and then we're just bringing different elements in or different parts to do different things. One of the really important things that a set designer thinks about is the design concept, when actually all the designers think about that when they come to a new show. Milsner wanted the past always present on stage when he was designing Death of a Salesman, because that's a lot of what motivates the main character. And this is something that a lot of designers will think about when they're creating the design concept. And the design concept is kind of like what is going to be the main visual theme of the piece. And there are a lot of different takes, obviously, on any one play. There can be lots of different ideas. But they work from that main idea, and then they try to infuse all of the set with that particular idea. So we can see, let me take that away. So here we can see this is actually a play that was done here a couple semesters ago, Loose Ends. And here we can see this is a unit set. It's intended to play a variety of areas. This is an outside scene. And here these were, there was this idea, a design concept that was developed between the designer and the director about the puzzle pieces of one's life coming together and how those pieces fit together to create the tapestry of your life. And so these cutouts were made to make sort of look like puzzle pieces. And then these scenes, these moments from this person's, this guy here is the main character, from his life, were sort of taken and put on each one of these. And that sort of served as the main backdrop and the main visual concept of the play, even though sometimes they were inside an apartment and sometimes, like they are here, they're supposed to be outside. So what are some of the objectives of scene design? Well, in addition to providing the environment, the mood, and the period, the style of the play, the scenic designer needs to help all the designers work together to fit in with his or her design concept. And one way to do that is with the central image. So what is the central visual image or the metaphor that we're going to use to unite this thing? And as we saw in that last one, the central image was sort of this idea of the pieces of one's life coming together. But there are lots of different central images or metaphors that people have worked that find in different pieces. Sometimes the script suggests it, or sometimes the designer can just come up with his or her own creative idea, or sometimes the director brings the sort of visual or metaphor to the design meeting, and then all the other designers build off of that. But for instance, a designer that was designing for Hamlet might choose to use netting as scenery to sort of like make that the main focus and to emphasize or make a metaphor of Hamlet's uncle's web of lies that's being created, right? And then we could also use that in the costumes and in the design for the program, and we could use it all over to sort of emphasize that visual metaphor. As I said in the last one, this idea of the puzzle pieces, we could use that throughout if we wanted to. We might even decide to dress someone in an outfit that had sort of these kind of figures that fit together in this particular way. One of the things that they did with the props was to kind of multi-purpose the props so that sometimes this thing was a chair, and sometimes then these hobby horses got something put on top of them and they were a table. So it was like a multiple set of pieces that were fitting together and constantly metamorphosizing throughout the life of this couple. So you can see how a central image or metaphor helps to unite all the design elements together to create a sort of cohesive production and to emphasize whatever that metaphor means and is hopefully pointing to sort of the theme of the piece. In Mother Courage, Bertolt Brecht in the stage directions talks about the metaphor of the wagon, and that's an image that's used through a lot of the productions of that piece as well as some of the original productions, this idea of the wagon, and Mother Courage always pulling the wagon, being attached to the wagon, and sort of her being this beast of burden that carries this wagon as a metaphor for the burden of her life, right? And so that's used throughout in a lot of different plays. The ground plan is an important part of scenic design. It's where the scenic designer sits down and he actually draws a two-dimensional, and this is a rendering, but this is a good example. We can bring this to full screen. This is actually what we call a rendering or a sketch. Sorry, I keep forgetting to take that off, of a set. And this is for a streetcar named Zaire. And you can see this is just an artist sketch, set designer's sketch of what the set might look like. We can also, sometimes this is also called an elevation, because we see how the actual flats will fit together in a sort of three-dimensional way, right? All the pieces, all the elevations here, this is a platform, right? And these are steps that go up, right? So we can see all of that in the sketch. And then next, from this step, usually once the director and the designer agree on something like this, the sketch, then the designer will move to what we call ground plan. And that is, again, almost like an architect's drawing of what the scenery will look like and the different elements that need to be built and their exact sizes, shapes, and all the technical stuff that the shop foreman will need in order to build that set and make it become a reality. There are certain things that the designer needs to think about that we don't think about when we're creating, you know, our regular homes or when we're doing everyday life things. And some of the things that they need to think about when creating a space that actors need to work in is that they want to have at least 5 acting areas to create 5 playable spaces on the set, 5 different areas that little scenes could take place in. And that doesn't necessarily mean 5 different rooms, but it means 5 sort of distinct spaces. If we go back to this picture real quick, I can kind of point those out on the streetcar picture here. Can we go back to the full screen? There we go, guys. Okay, so like if we were going to look at this, and I would say there are 5 spaces here, so we could do something here, on the bed. That's one. We have something here. That's two. Here's the kitchen. That's three. We also could use this space here. There's a chair. That's four. We have this space here. That's five. And also, I could do something here out on the steps, right? I could even do something here, maybe down. So actually, this has more than five spaces. But we're looking at when we're creating a set, we want to make sure that we have a minimum of five spaces. So there's a lot of variety. There's a lot of areas for the actors and the directors to explore to create interest when the play is working out. The other thing we want to do, and we can stick with this picture, is we want to try to put as little furniture against the wall as possible. Obviously, the refrigerator here needs to be against the wall. But you can see that this table here, lots of space around it. If there was a couch, we would want space around it. This bed is fine against the wall, but this chair, lots of space around it. We want to have as few things up against the wall as possible because we want to allow our actors clear traffic areas so that my actors can walk behind this, they can walk around, they can walk all around this, right? They can probably even walk behind this bed, right? And they can walk on this. We want to give as much area as possible for traffic, and that's really important. So, good, you've looked at that now. Let's talk about some of the other rules. Some of them are that we don't want to block entrances with furniture. We never want to have a couch in front of an entrance or a chair in front of an entrance. The walls should be broken up so that they're not all linear. As you see in that picture, we want to have angles. This helps to provide some depth for the audience. And the best entrances are from upstage, so we want to make sure that all of our doors that have important entrances are usually farther upstage than the rest of the action. And we want to make sure that all of our windows are downstage, so that if we have an actor looking through the window, even if it's an imaginary window, that they're looking at the audience. If the doors are on the sidewalls, they need to be hinged so that the opening door opens into the space so it doesn't block an actor's entrance, right? That's really important. Otherwise, we have actors getting stuck behind doors or getting, you know, blocked by doors. And that's not the way we do things in real life. We also want to observe sight lines. We want to make sure that no matter where the actor is inside of that set, that the audience can see what the actor is doing at all angles. And that's really important because if I, as an audience member, can't see what's happening, not only might I might miss something, but I might get frustrated and then I might disengage from the performance. So sight lines are really important. We want to make sure that we build the set out so that the sight lines are appropriate to the audience, meaning they can't see off stage, they can only see what's on stage, and that we have masking for anything. That means ways to block what's happening off stage so that the illusion of the theater is maintained, right? So all of these really important things that a designer has to think about when they're creating scenery for the stage. And also, it adds so much to the performance to have a really fantastic set to work on. Some of those sets are very realistic nowadays, as we've talked about. And some sets, even today, are not realistic. They're very expressionistic, meaning that they, instead of realistically representing a location, they more represent the internal life of the characters that they're living. So all different kinds of things that exist in the world of scenery. Well, guys, we've run out of time for today. Thank you so much for those of you that wrote in and called, Katie, as always. Don't forget to do your discussion board this week on Sunday and to take your test tonight by midnight. And you can take that test as often as you like until midnight tonight, and it will simply record the last one that you did. So good luck with all of that. Next week, we are going to be talking about acting or directing. I can't remember which. Well, I guess we'll find out next week, but I'm sure it will be exciting. And I look forward to seeing you all then. Keep doing your reading, keep doing your discussion boards, keep checking the assignment pages, and keep letting me know when there's mistakes because it always helps me so I can go back in and correct anything that's wrong. All right, guys, I hope you have a wonderful weekend. Good luck with your tests and your discussion board, and I'll see you next time.